हेलो फ्रेंड्स, नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू स्टार्ट सेकेंड यूनिट ऑफ योर सिलेबस, कमर्शियल बैंकिंग स्ट्रक्चर एंड फंक्शंस ऑफ द कमर्शियल बैंक्स। दिस इज स्पेसिफिकली फोकसिंग ऑन कमर्शियल बैंकिंग सिस्टम इन इंडिया एंड द वेरियस फंक्शंस एंड रोल परफॉर्म बाय द कमर्शियल बैंकिंग। दिस टॉपिक कवर्स स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ कमर्शियल बैंक, functions of commercial bank, primary and secondary function, role of commercial banks in socio-economic development of a country, services rendered by the commercial banks, and commercial banking technology, which has developed upcoming and developing very fast, and the benefit of this is being sought by all the commercial bank customers. The concept of universal banking, home banking, ATMs, internet banking, mobile banking, core banking solutions and debit, credit and smart cards, electronic payment systems, MICR, check truncation system, electronic fund transfer and NEFT, RTGS, all these we are studying in detail in this chapter. Specifically, let us understand what is commercial banking. In our lecture series 1, I would like to cover only three important aspects of the first model, the first part, that is commercial bank and its meaning, structure of commercial banks in India and functions of commercial banks. Rest of the things we will study subsequently in the other lectures. See lecture series 1 of unit 2. Let us understand what is commercial bank. When there is a commercial bank, there must be some banks which are non-commercial. As you know, the meaning of a commercial bank is an institution which accepts deposits. Any bank which accepts deposits from the public for the purpose of giving loans and advances to business activities and to general public. These commercial banks focus specifically the loans and advances given to business activities. Business activities. Any business, how we define a business, is any activity which is continuous in nature and which main focus is to earn the profit. Those profit activity ventures are provided loans and advances. And the main motto of this commercial bank is to earn the profit out of the commercial activities. Another important motto of this bank is also profit. These commercial banks provide loans and advances to the business activities, to the general public, and the main focus of this commercial bank is to earn the profit. They are not for other than profit. They are basically meant for earning the profit, commercial banks. If you consider most of the banks today existing around us in the society, all of them are commercial banks. Very few are non-commercial banks. Let us understand what are the commercial banks. Take an example of State Bank of India. Take an example of Union Bank of India. Take an example of ICICI Bank. Take an example of Hong Kong Shanghai Bank. All these banks' main motto is to earn profit. They are not for non-profit. They are not non-profit organizations. They are profit organizations. How do a bank earn a profit? The banks earn the profit out of the differences between the deposit interest and the loan interest. Normally, these banks issue the loans and advances above the loans and advances, they are above the interest paid to the deposit holder. Suppose if they take a fixed deposit at 8%, they give the loans and advances at 12 to 13% to the public. The difference between the two is the profit. Apart from this, these banks are also engaged in other activities to earn the profit, like fund transfer and all that. That we will study detail in the functions of the bank. The main motto of these banks is to earn the profit. They are registered as a profit earning organizations with the Reserve Bank of India. Then let us understand what are the non-profit banks available around us. There are many non-profit organization banks also, like for example, all cooperative banks. Main motto is not to earn the profit. The main motto is to self-help, help to the group. we have NABARD, National Bank for Rural Development, Agriculture and Rural Development Bank. So NABARD is basically providing the loans advances to the rural people for agricultural development. The main motto is not to earn the profit, but to develop the sectors. Like we have so many other banks, like the government, RBI, Reserve Bank of India, is also a non-profit organization. Main motto is to provide the service, but not the profit. But these commercial banks' main motto is to earn the profit. Let us understand the structure of commercial banks in India. If you see the commercial banks in India, they are also classified into scheduled commercial banks and non-scheduled commercial banks. Scheduled commercial banks are those banks which are scheduled in the list of Reserve Bank of India. To get the name in the scheduled list, every bank should have certain norms to be satisfied. First of all, the paid up share capital of that particular bank should be above the particular limit. It is more than 5 lakhs. More than paid up share capital. The bank should have a share capital, and the paid up share capital is more than 5 lakhs. It should have established for the last 5 years, and the bank's statements should have been audited. And these banks, once they are entered in the list of the scheduled list of the Reserve Bank of India, they have to follow the rules and regulations as per the Reserve Bank of India. There are many non-scheduled commercial banks are also there. They may be certain small banks operating in the rural areas, but not having a paid up share capital more than 5 lakhs. But these banks do not have any full control by the Reserve Bank of India. But some of these credit cooperative societies in the rural areas whose total paid up share capital is less than 5 lakhs, they are not scheduled banks, but they work under urban cooperative banks or Apex cooperative banks and all that. So the big cooperative banks are going to control these small cooperative banks. They are called as non-scheduled banks. But in commercial banks, non-scheduled banks are very few. They are not perfectly operating in the country. If you see the scheduled commercial banks, they are again classified into three: private sector banks, public sector banks, and foreign banks. If you see the private sector bank, how do you define a private sector bank? Private sector bank is the one where the investment is not at all made by the government. The investment will be made by the general public, that is outsiders. The private people will invest the money. Maybe the industrialist, maybe the open public buying the shares of these banks and all that. They are called as private sector banks. Public sector banks are those where the investment is made by the government to a certain extent, where the government is investing more than 50% of the total capital and becomes the manager of that particular bank. Therefore, these banks are called as public sector banks. They are called as public sector bank because the government invests money. How do government generate the money? Government generate the money for the investment out of the tax paid by the public. Therefore, it is a public's money that is being invested in the banks. That is why it is called as public sector bank. When it is a public sector bank, the management is always from the government. So the government is going to control whole activities of the banking. All decisions are being made by the government authorities through financial representations in the banking management style. Apart from these two, we have foreign sector banks also. The foreign sector banks are the banks where the head office is in the foreign countries. These are the foreign banks having operations in India. So these head offices are there in their own country, their home country, and they are having the branches in our country. So there are certain banks which are having a representation of head offices in our country also. But all that banks are called as a foreign sector banks because here investment is made by the foreign countries, other countries, in the form of foreign direct investment in banking sector. So these are called as foreign banks. In private sector, public sector and foreign sector banks, there can be public limited banks and private limited banks. That don't confuse with the sectors. Public limited bank is the one which is having the share capital, whose shares are freely floated. That is what we call as the articles of association of any company, if it does not restrict the free flow of the shares among the members and does not restrict the maximum number of members to the extent of 50, such banks are called as public limited. Such companies are called as public limited companies. So don't get confused with the style of establishment of a company and the sectors. Sectors are different. Limited companies are different. Public limited companies. Many a time when I ask a question to us, any student, what is public limited company? He will say it's a government company. No, not like that. Public limited company is a one which does not restrict by its articles of association the maximum number of members to 50, free flow of shares and securities. That is called a public limited company. Private limited company is one which by its articles restricts the maximum number of members to 50 and restricts the transfer of the shares. If at all the shares of any private limited company has to transfer from one share member to another member, then the permission from the company has to be sought as per the private sector, private limited company organization. But in public limited company, you need not require to ask any person. You can easily transfer the shares because the maximum number of members is not limited. So therefore, it is a sector. Based on the sectoral differences, we can have private sector bank, public sector bank, and foreign bank. Private sector bank is the bank where the investment is made by the private people, not by the government of India. Public sector banks are the banks where the investment is made by the government of India. More than 50% is normally invested, therefore it becomes a public bank. If it is a less than 50%, the investment of the government is less than 50%, it becomes joint sector, because private people management will be more there, government investment is less. Such banks are not available in India. So we have only public sector banks where the investment is more than 50%. We have foreign banks on the other hand. Public sector banks are again classified into State Bank of India and its subsidiaries and other nationalized banks. State Bank of India, its subsidiaries. State Bank of India has got 7 subsidiaries of its own. But now, recently, all State Bank of India branches are merged, and it has become one single State Bank of India. Now, this classification is not required. Other nationalized banks are also. Let us understand the full lengthy list of the public sector banks in India. If you see the public sector banks in India, there are hardly 12 public sector banks. Earlier, we had 27 public banks, public sector banks. But now, the total strength is reduced to 12 banks. As per the Narasimhan Committee, there should be merging of the banks for reducing the NPA and becoming more powerful in the capital. If there are more banks, capital is less. If two banks merge together, the capital of the bank will be more to render the services to the public. Therefore, the merging concept has been implemented. Recently in 2015 and 2018, something like that, some banks got merged. So if you see today, there are six banks which are independent. Bank of India, Bank of Maharashtra, Central Bank of India, Indian Overseas Bank, Punjab and Sindh Bank, and UCO Bank. These are the independent banks. Indian Bank again got merged with Allahabad Bank. Earlier we had an Allahabad nationalized bank. They are called as nationalized banks because these banks are considered to be public sector banks where the investment of the government is more than 50%. If you see the government shareholding in Bank of India, it is 87.1%. If you see Bank of Maharashtra, it is 87%. So even in State Bank of India, the government investment is hardly 61%, but still then State Bank of India is called as a government bank. And Canara Bank and Bank of Baroda and all that. If you see Union Bank of India got recently two banks merged with it in the year 2018-19. Andhra Bank and the Corporation Bank got merged with Union Bank of India. Punjab National Bank again, Oriental Bank of Commerce and United Bank of India got merged with the Punjab National Bank. And State Bank of India had 7 subsidiaries of its own called State Bank of Bikaner in Jaipur, State Bank of Hyderabad, State Bank of Indore, State Bank of Mysore, State Bank of Patiala, State Bank of Saurashtra and State Bank of Tiruvankur, but all these banks got merged and they become a single bank called State Bank of India. And Bharatiya Mahila Bank is also merged with the State Bank of India. State Bank of India has taken over this Bharatiya Mahila Bank after the nationalization. And Canara Bank is merged with Syndicate Bank. Now today you don't have an existence of Syndicate Bank. Instead of that, you have a Canara Bank, because all the assets of the Canara Banks are merged with the, Syndicate Banks are merged with the Canara Bank. Bank of Baroda taken out Vijaya Bank and Dena Bank. Earlier, Vijaya Bank and Dena Banks were nationalized banks operating in the economy, but now they have totally been merged with the Bank of Baroda. So totally, we have right now 12 public sector banks in India. If you see the private sector banks, private sector bank is having their around extensive list of 22 banks. These private sector banks are run and managed by the private investment. Axis Bank, Bandhan Bank, Catholic Syrian Bank, City Union Bank. So these banks are having some foreign investment share and some public share. But the Indian citizens' share is more in these banks. Therefore, they are called as private sector banks in India. HDFC Bank, for example, ICICI Bank. So earlier, HDFC, ICICI, IDBI were non-banking financial units. But now they are also taking deposits and working like a normal bank and registered with the Reserve Bank of India as a bank. Therefore, they are all scheduled banks only. Now they have got the name of the scheduled banks. So the extensive 22 banks are list of private sector banks in India. There are 22 private sector banks. If you see the foreign banks in India, its list is around 46. So they are having one or two branches in the metros and all that. They are not spread throughout the country like our national. Only Standard Chartered Bank is having around 100 branches in India. And you could see many branches of Standard Chartered Bank around you. If you go to Bangalore, if you go to Mysore, if you go to Mumbai and all that, Standard Chartered Banks in city area. These banks do not operate in the village area. They operate in a well-established urban areas like metros and capital cities of the nations. So this is what we call as foreign banks operating in India. These banks' main headquarters are established in their own country. Like AB Bank Limited is basically from Bangladesh, having a headquarter in Bangladesh, but having only one branch in Delhi. Like that, we have Standard Chartered Bank, especially from United Kingdom, that is UK, America, England, and having 100 banks in India. So like that, we have foreign banks. Now, if you see the functions of the commercial bank functions are basically classified into three: primary functions, agency functions, and general functions. A lot of questions will be asked every year in this. Discuss the basic functions of commercial banks in India. So the answer will be list. You have to explain each point in detail, giving an example. Primary function, I'll just discuss the nutshell. In this, I may not be able to go too deep because the time availability is very less. Primary function involves receiving deposits and giving loans and advances. If you take any commercial banks, the receipt of deposits are basically in four types. One is fixed deposit. Fixed deposit is also called as time deposit, because once the customer deposits money here, a specific period of time is locked in. The customer can withdraw money from the bank after the expiry of a specific period of time. In between, if he is going to withdraw, there will be some penalties charged by the bank on an urgency basis. And sometimes the banker may deny also if there is any cash problem with him. So the customer who has kept the money in the fixed deposit cannot have a rights to withdraw 100% before the expiry of the time. But if he is ready to pay the penalty and if the bank is ready to accept that proposal by charging penalty, then transaction may happen. Otherwise, it will not. That's called a time deposit. It's also called as fixed deposit. The second type of deposit is a savings bank deposit. Normally, Open Public is given the facility for banking services. Here, the deposits can be made by the customer at any time, but the withdrawals have a limits. You can withdraw. You cannot withdraw more than specific amount, say for example 1 lakh at a time, and within a week's time you cannot withdraw more than 3 times. or these restrictions may be changing as per the rules. So these are called as savings bank deposit. The main motive of this deposit is to increase the saving habit among the public. And the banker is providing a floating basis of interest depending on the deposit amount available for that particular banking period, like 6 months. Every 6 months, the interest is calculated on the deposit which is kept for 6 months, ceiling of deposits like that. And the third one is the current account current account deposits. Current account deposits refers to the deposits made at any time, withdrawals are made at any time. Normally, banker do not provide any interest on this. These kind of things are accounts are opened by the business people for banking services, for giving the checks and all that, for collecting the money from somebody else. So current account is being opened. Current account is normally provided to the business people or corporate houses. And the last one is recurring deposit, RDs, what we call as recurring deposit. Most of the banks receive these recurring deposits where the deposits are made on every time interval. Say, for example, weekly, quarterly, monthly, fortnightly, like that. So these deposits, once they are collected, there is a specific period of time, say, for example, 5 years, 10 years. The customer has to deposit money regularly on a time interval, specific time interval basis. After the whole collection of the money, after the expiry of that agreed period of time, banker will pay the interest on that and return the money to the deposit holders. Normally, the daily earners and the people who earn the money on the daily basis will keep these deposits. It is also like a savings bank deposit, but only the difference is in recurring deposits, you cannot withdraw the money as per your will and wish. So this is what we call as recurring deposits. Even post offices are also providing recurring deposit facilities, but we do not call the post office as a bank, basically because they do not receive current accounts and savings bank accounts. They do not receive. So what is the concept here is to call any bank, there must be accepting of deposits, specifically savings bank account and current account banks. Fixed deposit may be taken by even post offices. Fixed deposits even may be taken as recurring deposits may be taken by post offices, but they are not called as banks. And the post office main motto is not to advance the loans and things out of the collected deposits. But here the banks will be giving loans and advances out of these deposits. Now, if you see the commercial banks loans and advances are provided by the commercial banks in many ways. First one we call as microfinancing, called short-term loans. Short-term loans are provided to small business activities and all that. As and when the money is required, people can withdraw money out of their total loans sanctioned and utilize it. The term for this is less than 1 year. Any loan which is more than 1 year but less than 5 years is called as medium-term loans. Medium-term loans are given for specific activities like business purposes and all that. And long-term loans are the loans provided to the customers for asset constructions, asset building and all that. Normally home loans, industrial development loans, and some other kinds of loans which are availed by the business people or farmers for purchasing of land are called as long-term loans. Short-term loans are provided out of security deposits, securities, collateral securities like gold, silver, or any other metals or any other sureties like personal loans and all kinds of short-term loans. Within 1 year, it has to be paid back. But whereas the medium-term loans are given again for business development purposes, and long-term loans are normally given for fixed assets development purposes. So these are the various kinds of loan services that are functions provided by them. Then we have called agency function. Banker acts like a middleman in between the buyers and sellers, or in between two parties, where some of the activities are done as an agent. They are called as agency function. Collection and payment services. Banker is going to collect the money on behalf of the customers from any payers. For example, if you have a mutual fund and attach that mutual fund to the bank account, banker on your behalf will collect the interest on the regular basis from the mutual fund investments on your behalf. Payment services are also made by on behalf of the customers to the third party. Like if you want to pay the LIC premium every month that you are supposed to pay, and if you give an ECS electronic fund transfer system to the banker on every month basis on your behalf, the insurance premium is paid by the banker on your behalf without your knowledge. So you can forget that payments, but banker will be doing activity on your behalf. This is called, we call as payment service. Purchase and sale. On behalf of you, the banker is also providing a purchase and sale of certain what you call as securities, certain bonds and all that. On your behalf, you can buy the bonds. On your behalf, you can sell the bonds. Execution of standing instructions. If there are any standing instructions that every month or every quarterly, this fees of the particular school has to be paid, banker will pay on your behalf as per the instructions. So they follow the standing instructions of the customers. Collection of dividends and interest on the securities. If at all you have any investments in the form of stocks and all that, the interest of that particular stock will be, dividends will be collected by the banker. So you can give the banker as a middleman to collect the money on your behalf to the companies for payment of the dividends. Companies will not pay the dividends in your hands, but they will deposit the money in the bank. So banker will convey that message to you that dividend has been received, and keep that money in your savings bank account or in your current account as the case may be. Transfer of funds. If the funds are to be transferred from one person to another person, like earlier we have money transfer, MO, by the post office, but today even banks are doing this activity. So there is an electronic system of fund transfer which is made easy for the people to transfer any amount from one person to another person. Today bankers are providing this electronic fund transfer facilities called NIFTs, RTGS and all that. Bank as a guarantor. Sometimes the banker will act like a guarantor on your behalf. He will be able to give the what you call as a guarantee to the customers for any of these basic. So guarantee will not be given to any person. Guarantee will be given only to the specific customers whose credit worthiness is high, having a more deposits with the bank. Such persons will be given a guarantee for any of the transactions like buying and selling, or maybe for any of the cases, banker can act like a guarantor. Income tax facility. You can pay income tax even through the banker, and collection of any charity, zakats, alms on your behalf will also be made. But today, what happened, you know, most of these trusts and all that were ready to collect the money. They are opening an account with the banker, and the banker's transaction ID is given to all the people. Any person from the country, if they want to pay money, they can just deposit the money in the bank, and banker is going to collect that money and give to the particular charity organization. For example, recently for COVID, Prime Minister has opened a charity account for COVID. Central Finance Ministry has opened an account, and account number was distributed. Any person, even 10 rupees or even 1 rupee he wants to contribute, he can just fill the application and pay it to any bank. So that amount was collected on behalf of the government, and it is given to the government for helping the COVID related patients and all that. So this is how we call as alms and charities. We have certain general functions. General functions means the functions which are not falling in the primary and secondary, they are called as general functions. Now today, the general function is concerned, insurance, these bankers are involved in issuance of letter of credit. What is a letter of credit? Letter of credit avails in the foreign export and imports. Say for example, if Indian person wanted to buy goods from America, so the goods will be produced after the order is placed. Say for example, we are buying a furniture of 1 crore rupees by any Indian person from America. So once you place an order, against the order, as per your design, they produce the product. So the production will take its own time. Say for example, a month of time or a 2 months time. And once you place an order, both the parties are unknown to each other because they are not seen personally. They are doing it through Google accounts and all that, looking at that. So each person may not be able to trust on each other. So the person who is in America, if at all he was to prepare the product, produce the product, he should have a guarantee that its price is paid after the delivery. And the person in India wants a guarantee that he will pay money. He will pay money, but the delivery has to happen in, after that the payment is made. The person who is in America needs certain kinds of advance money. But the person in India may not be able to give an advance. Say, for example, if it is 1 crore, he is expecting around 50 lakhs to be paid in advance. But how this Indian person will trust the foreign person? Once the payment is made directly, he may not be able to produce it and he may deceive him. So that kind of feeling is there between the parties. In such cases, banker will come into existence and help for the transaction. What is this letter of credit? Letter of credit is the money. If the Indian buyer, furniture buyer, keeps around 50 lakhs with the banker, giving instruction that he issue a letter of credit on my behalf to the foreign producer, that is the furniture producer, banker will take this deposit and issue a letter of credit to the that particular bank. That letter of credit can be encashed in America by the bank where that producer is having an account. So here two banks will give a trust to each other. Once the money is withdrawn, he can start the production activity of the foreign person, and the produced product can be sold to us, sold to Indian person. So after that delivery happens, the remaining 50 lakhs will be paid directly to the person and accounts are settled. So this credit note, which is issued to the foreign banks on behalf of the foreign producer by as per the request of the Indian person, is called as letter of credit. For this, banker charges a certain service charges to the customers, but customer is ready to pay the service charges because there will be a trust, there will be a guarantee that money will not go waste, because there are two different banks operating in different countries will get involved in the letter of credit. We will have a detailed discussion of this letter of credit in a next more this one when we are discussing the banking activities in the next. The next one is issuance of traveler's check, discounting bills. You know that bills discounting already, bills payments and bills receivables and all that. So discounting of bill will be similar to this within the city. If it is between the country, it is a letter of credit normally. If it is within the country, it is called as discounting of bills. Then issuance of the traveler's check. Issuance of traveler's check refers to when the traveler is traveling from one place to another place, instead of carrying the money with him, he may take the bank channel and use it as and when required. So earlier it was more nature, but today because of debit cards and all that, it's not necessary. Traveler's check in the sense, if the person from one country to another country is moving, he can deposit the rupee in India, take a traveler's check, go to USA and encash it in the form of dollars and all that. Accordingly, this is what we call as traveler's checks normally used. Locker facility, safe call locker facility, everybody knows it. Any safety products which are there with the customer cannot keep at a home because of burglary, theft and all that. Therefore, these safe locker facilities provided by the banker where he can keep the valuables in the bank, and the banker is giving him a key and all that. As and when required, he can open that particular compartment and get his products like that. This is called locker facility. Foreign exchange transactions, when the money has to convert between two countries, we have commercial banks involved in it, especially the State Bank of India and big banks are highly engaged in these kind of transactions. Any foreigner coming to India can go to the Indian bank and convert his dollar into rupee. And Indian person, when he is going to foreign countries and all that, can go to commercial banks and convert rupee into dollars like that. These conversion facilities are provided by them. And act as an underwriter many a times on behalf of the customers, especially the companies and all that. Selling of securities are made, guarantee of providing the stock sellings in the market or share selling in the market. The bankers are today acting like an underwriters. Underwriters are the people who are giving a security for the minimum collection of money through issue of shares in the market. Or on your behalf, they are going to collect the money and provide you. That is what we call as underwriting activity. We'll see this underwriting activity when we are discussing non-banking financial activities done by the bankers. So now here your topic will get over. I thank the students for patience listening. So we will see the remaining aspect, role of commercial banks and all that in the next chapter.